Okay, so we give him a great big Odyssey. Now, the other thing about Ben is he gives you a lot more work than Rob does. So I'm going to hand out these papers as he gets ready and gets prepared this morning. And it's fill in the blank.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. I was talking to somebody not long ago, and actually I was sharing with them about some difficulties that I was having. And the person on the phone said to me, "This is the day." I said, "You're right. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it." And so, whatever your day is, maybe this morning already, there were things, we all know the things, come into our lives. But be reminded that the Lord is in charge of this day. And we've come today to worship. We've come today to learn. We've come today to avail ourselves. A week has passed. A new day has come. And God wants to do something new in our lives. I like that about God, because he doesn't just give us something and then it just, you know, becomes old. But it becomes new every day as we dwell upon the Word and we dwell upon the love that God has for each one of us. But today is Pentecost Sunday, and a lot of churches do not celebrate this this holy day, as we would call it. They may have it in their polity, they may have it in their discipline, but they do not. And some do celebrate it, but they don't celebrate it. You know what I mean? They celebrate it with their mouth, but their heart is far from God. They do not understand really what it's all about. And today we're going to share just a part of what that is. And if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Acts chapter 2. And we'll be looking at verse 1 through 8 and then 11b through 13. So let us stand together for the reading of God's Word this morning. Acts chapter 2 and verse 1. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. And all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard the sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard them speaking in his own language. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Are not all these men who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in his native language? We hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues." Amazing and perplexed, they ask one another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said, they are full of new wine. Let us pray. Our Father, we've come today to hear from heaven, and to see the face of Jesus, and to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit. We pray today, Lord, that as the Spirit is here and with us, that he will speak through this living letter that you've given to us, and that it will be applied to our hearts in such a way that it will be undeniable what we have heard and what we have experienced and what we embrace in the Christian faith, and to know there's none other that we should embrace but Christ, him crucified, risen, and now our coming King. Bless us today and help us. May our understanding be enlarged. And may we receive what you have for us today. We pray this in the powerful name of Christ and for his sake. Amen. May be seated. Amen. The first word of our text says, chooses the word when. When. You'll find as I preach this morning that, of course, everyone is different. I can't be Pastor Rob, and he wouldn't want me to be Pastor Rob, and Pastor Rob wouldn't want me to be him. And so God uses the vessel that we are, that is extended and is open and willing to speak his word. And so that's why we're here this morning. But the first word of our text begins a certain timeline of events that were to follow. And that first word is the word when. When speaks of a particular time in the timeline of God's overall plan to bring the message of his son, Jesus Christ, as the Savior of the world in the focus. Now, before the timeline of these events were written in Acts 2, there came to be as a command that Jesus gave his disciples just before he left them. And so we find the first word is when, but the second word is found in Acts chapter 1 and verse 3 through 5 and then verse 8. Acts 1, 3 through 5 and verse 8. After Jesus' suffering, he showed himself to these men and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Now, when we see what Christ had done in 3 years, and his disciples had followed him, and now he had brought them together again after his resurrection, and he is sharing with them timely truths that would help them to bridge the gap from the time that he would lead them and the time that the promised Holy Spirit would come. It was very important that the Holy Spirit would come and would be with them as Jesus left them. But why wait? Why wait for the promise? The answer is simple. The first answer is that Jesus was still with them. Jesus had told his disciples, I must go, and when I go, I will send you the Spirit of Truth, the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, that will give you power, that will speak in my name, that will help you to remember what I've said, and will give you the words to speak. And I remember a time, of course, being in the ministry, things happened, and I had left the pastorate and for a number of years, and I went. They asked me back for a funeral. The man had committed suicide. I never had a suicide before. Big family. And it was a difficult time for them to grapple the whole idea that their loved one had shot himself. He was an alcoholic. He was tormented by a number of things. His mother was sickly, and he thought, well, I've had enough of it, and my mother's had enough of it. So his plan was to kill his wife, kill his mother, and then kill himself. But what he didn't realize is that God had other plans for his family and also for him, because his two brothers, who were in the Marines, and he was also in the Marines, had showed up at his door at about the time he was going to do this. And so the mother was spared, the wife was spared, but he took his life. And so I remember it was an open casket, believe it or not. It was a very difficult time. It was closed to the outside, just family. And I remember the anger and the lostness of these people as they're grappling with the fact that they have a loved one that committed suicide. And in fact, I was up by the casket, and one of the sisters of the deceased thought it was somebody else and started hitting on me. I mean, not hitting on me, I mean hitting me. And then almost knocked the casket over, and the funeral director was just like beside herself. They're like, oh my goodness, what are we going to do? You know, and so it came to me just like that, and it had to be the Holy Spirit. I said to the funeral director, have them sit down, I want to talk to them. I just sit down beforehand and say, well, you know, here's what I'm going to say if this happens. Or maybe if this happens, I'll do this. No, the Holy Spirit was with me. And so they sat down, and you hear a pin drop, and I said, you know, I have no idea what you're going through. I don't know what's happening in your life right now. I know you've lost a loved one. You're in shock. Some of you are in denial. Some think that they did it. It was something they did or could have done. And so there's all kinds of things going on. And then I said, oh, also, there's the question. I didn't have to say what the question was. They knew what the question was. The question was, he took his life. Where is he now? And I said, And again, this was not me. This was not rehearsed. It wasn't something that I, you know, I, in a college class, and they said, now that this happens, you do this. No, the Holy Spirit was with me. And so what I said to them was that is that we have the question, and there needs to be answered, and only God can answer those questions. And the answer to the question is that God is a holy God, and God will judge, and he will speak to the issue of what has happened to your loved one, and he knows through his holiness and through the holiness of his character what he will do.
Amen.
And they all hushed, and one of them missed it completely and said, oh, he was a good man. He'd take the shirt off his back. But it calmed them to think that I was calm, because I knew the kind of man he was. And they thought through that, through the holiness and the character of God and the judgment of God, that he would allow this. And not only this man was not a Christian. There was a far cry from a Christian, and he lived a very sinful life. Of course, only God will know and judge. But it did not give me comfort sharing that with them, because God is a holy God, and man does not want to fall into the hands of an angry God. And so I was given that because the Spirit of Truth was with me. But at this time, Jesus was still with them. The Spirit of Truth could not come. The second is, on God's timetable, the command of Jesus to his disciples to wait came 10 days short of the harbingers God had put into place. Now, you say, well, that word harbinger, that's a different word. What is that? Now, a harbinger, it is an event that announces the reality of something greater that is to come to pass. This all ties to the reference point in the biblical text and the significance of the word when. It's that there was something that happened in the past that God had set up, but now he's going to fulfill through Pentecost and the coming of the Holy Spirit. And so the time was not yet. Is that there had to be a time within a timetable of what God wanted to do, and there had to be a day that would come. And that's when the first word that I uttered to you in the scripture, it says, when the day of Pentecost had come. And I think in the King James it says, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, because there was 50 days, but now this was the last day that was to come. But the Holy Spirit could not come until Jesus had left, and there was a period of time that would come to mark the harbinger that was given before of the significance of something that was going to happen in the future. Is that we see in the Old Testament, and there's so many things, it's amazing how the Old Testament is connected with the New Testament. You see, when you study the tabernacle, all the different things that speak of Christ, and the temple, all the things that speak of the coming Christ that was to come. But now we have this Feast of Pentecost that is a harbinger of something that was given in the past that now is coming to fruition, and the disciples had to wait because of that. Now, the mystery that needs to be solved about this harbinger, this something that is greater that has come to pass, is in the book of Leviticus in chapter 23 and verses 1 and 2. And here it says, and the Lord said to Moses, speak to the Israelites and say to them, these are my appointed feasts, the appointed feasts of the Lord, which you are to proclaim as sacred assemblies. It is here that God reveals the seven harbingers. Now, often you look at that scripture, you may not even associate, you know, this word harbinger. But all of these feasts were shadows of what was to come and would be fulfilled in the life and the death and the resurrection and the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ in his second coming. And so this morning, I hope I have your attention, because this is really exciting. This is something that is just incredible. Now, the feasts were these, and I'm going to go over these very quickly. The first feast, and we'll come to the Feast of Pentecost, but the first feast was the Feast of Passover. The Feast of Passover was commemorating the deliverance of the Jews from slavery in Egypt. A lamb was killed and the blood was spilled, and they were to put it over the doorposts of their dwelling, and the death angel would pass over them, and their firstborn would not be killed. But we know all of the Egyptians' firstborn was killed. Now, when we look at that, Good Friday, as we know it, is the day of Passover. And it is that very day that Jesus was crucified as the Lamb of God. Do you see the connection? We see the Passover Lamb, and we have the what was foretold by John the Baptist when he pointed to Jesus, and he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God that will take away the sin of the world." And so we see here is Jesus. He is fulfilling this that was to come, that was a shadow of what was to come in the blood that was spilt by Jesus Christ. Do I hear an amen?
Amen.
The second is the Feast of Unleavened Bread. This feast came the next day after the Feast of the Passover. And leaven signified sin and evil. It was God's way of saying, okay, this leaven that we use to make our bread a little higher than, you know, just a flat pancake, it signifies how just a little bit of something can bring uncleanness to the whole. And some people say, well, I'm not very much of a sinner. I said, well, if you're a sinner, it doesn't matter if you're a big sinner or a small sinner, or you commit a few sins or a lot of sins, you're still a sinner in God's eyes, and that sin has to be taken care of by the blood of Christ. And so as Jesus lay in the grave, after he was killed on the cross, he gave his life, he lay in the grave, and God made him to be a sin offering for all mankind. One who knew no sin. Now the scripture says he made him sin, and actually he's talking about he made him as a sin offering. Does that mean that Christ became, in fact, all the sin of the world came upon him at that time, as he bore the sin of mankind as he was on the cross. But now he's in the grave, a man with no sin, but God made him sin, an offering for all mankind. The third is the Feast of First Fruits. This, you had Passover, unleavened bread, but then you have the Feast of First Fruits, and that came 2 days after Passover. You see the progression here. It's amazing. It's just incredible. I know someone who was a Jew that raised a Jew. She was adopted into a family, and she recently gave her heart to the Lord, and after 2.5 months she recanted and said she went back to the old way. She said, I've seen the correlation between the Old Testament and the New, and then Christ coming, and I'm going to go back. My Messiah has not come. It was a very difficult time for me. As this became a reality, because I poured a lot into her as far as Bible study and follow-up things. We know God's word does not return to him void.
That's right.
No. God's word does not return empty. And this is a woman that was up in New Jersey, had some difficulty, and came in this area to get away from stuff. But she encountered the Lord Jesus Christ. And as your pastor shared about the love, is that, yes, we are to be God's hands and God's eyes and God's ears, and we're to give sacrificially to people and love them to himself. And this is what we did. We just not give her things. We just not give her of our time, but we gave her ourselves. And that's the key. It's not about of giving, like, well, I did this. I went out, I took a vet up to the Veterans Hospital. Okay? I gave some hours of my time. And yes, I went to our neighbor who thus can't afford things, and I power washed their house. But see, they don't know it. Maybe they don't recognize it, but I just didn't do something. I gave them myself. And as Christians, that's what God wants us to do. As Christ gave himself on the cross sacrificially, we are to give ourselves, not just of ourselves, but ourselves. And so we see here that this Feast of First Fruits, it came 2 days after Passover. To us Christians, it is the day of resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It is that day that he came out of that grave. And we see in 1 Corinthians 15:20, it tells us Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. Now, the issue there, they were talking about those that had given their hearts to Christ, but now they had died. What's going to happen to them? And Paul shares with them there that Christ was the first fruits, and those who are dead in Christ will truly be raised from the dead. Now, the fourth feast is the Feast of Weeks, Pentecost, 50 days after the Feast of the First Fruits, 50 days after the resurrection of Christ on that first day of the week when he came out of the grave and he showed the power of God in his life. We see in things in perspective, there's things that the flesh would say do, but the Spirit says no. The Spirit says no, you praise God, and it'll work out. And it does. And all those different things, we had things donated to us, and other things happened where the guy came and he donated his time. And you know, we got everything almost done, except as Rob would know, and he would tell you that, you know, a car can work, but you can't do much about the loose nut behind the wheel. I mean, just, that never will be fixed. I mean, just no way. This morning, I want you to know that in recent days, I've been attacked by the devil through my dreams. And it's been very difficult. But you know, you persevere and you do what you know is right, and you pray to God and you ask him for what you need, and he will give you what you need.
Amen.
See, that's the power of the Holy Spirit. Today, if you don't have that power. You know, what's so neat about this is that, and that's a weird word, neat, we don't use that word much anymore, neat, is that, see, you know, we can be filled with the Holy Spirit, but, you know, we leak. We leak, and we need to be refilled with the Holy Spirit. And we see that whenever the disciples were up against it, went before the council there in chapter 6 and 7 of Acts. And it says they came back together. They said they're told us not to speak in the name of Jesus. And it says they prayed and they were filled again with the Holy Spirit. And so this morning, as we close this service, let's stand together. And if this morning you need to be filled with the Holy Spirit on this Pentecost Sunday, I want you to come forward and we will pray. Let's stand together. And ask the Holy Spirit. This morning, as I pray, Holy Spirit, O Son of God, powerful God, we come to you today and give you praise that you have given us not just a shadow, but you have given us reality through the blood of Christ and through the promise of the Father that this harbinger would come to pass and that first Pentecost came, and there's been many, many Pentecosts that have come since, and it has enabled the church to be the church, to be called out of the world, and to be separate from the world, but not to be in the world, and to be able to share the love of the Father. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, we pray this in Jesus' powerful name. Amen.
Amen.
Awesome.
I want to thank Ben this morning.